Thank you very much. At this time, we'll have silent meditation and follow that with the Pledge of Allegiance. Thank you.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Recognitions, achievements, and awards.
Good evening, Mr. President, Mr. Superintendent, and members of the board. Tonight, I'm pleased to recognize many outstanding individuals from the Clarke County School District. Honorees, when I call your name, please come forward to the podium, accept your certificate, and shake all of the board members' hands. First up, we would like to recognize Board Vice President Sarah Ellis for being an Athena Award nominee. The Athena Award is presented annually to an individual who has been nominated for embodying the highest level of professional excellence in her business or profession, dedicating time and energy to better the quality of life for others in the community and helping women reach their full potential. The winner will be announced at the Athens Area Chamber of Commerce's annual meeting to be held February 15th. Tonight, we would like to recognize Mrs. Ellis for being named a nominee for this prestigious award. Very well deserved. Making a superior rating for drum major. This drum major was actually first in Class A, and so tonight we would like to recognize Davion Pope from Clarke Central High School for being the number one drum major in Class A. Congratulations. Davion received a superior rating, and receiving an excellent rating were the full band, color guard, and percussion. And so tonight we also want to recognize Director Robert Lawrence. Also from Clarke Central this evening, we would like to recognize Joseph Weston Clarke for being named to All-State Orchestra. All-State Orchestra is the top honor orchestra in the state and will occur March 3rd through 5th at the Classic Center. Joseph is in 10th grade and plays the French horn. Congratulations. We had one more student. She couldn't be here tonight, but I did want to say that Angelina Choi from Cedar Shoals High School was also selected for All-State Honor Orchestra and was also selected first chair in the orchestra and cello. So we're really proud to have these students. And again, they will perform March 3rd through 5th at the Classic Center right here in Athens. Now we'd like to recognize our school district's plant services department as well as business partners, because working together, the Clarke County School District was named the grand prize winner for its green cleaning efforts by American School and University Magazine in its December 2015 edition. The district's plant services department began the initiative in fall 2011, and now 21 schools and 4 administrative sites are incorporated in our green cleaning practices. Last year, our district was named an honorable mention and has since implemented a variety of initiatives. The program launched with custodial staff using color-coded microfiber cloths, adding HEPA-filtered backpack vacuums, and more. Now there's also a pilot program in 4 schools to use engineered water for further reducing chemical cleaning use. Staff are actually now able to make a neutral pH disinfectant that has a 30-second reaction rate for 99.9% of microorganisms. Custodial staff receive 15 to 20 hours of training each year on cleaning procedures, including indoor air quality, mold and moisture, chemical storage, and leaks. And so this is just another way that we are proud to be best in the nation, so we're the number one school district for green cleaning practices. our schools safe. And so tonight, first, we will recognize all of the members of our green cleaning team from the Clarke County School District. Michael Brookins, custodial supervisor. Steve Dorsch, safety and energy coordinator. Cornelius Edwards, warehouse supervisor. Tammy Scruggs, administrative assistant. Veronica Jackson, contract specialist. Stacy Stevens, custodial supervisor. And for their leadership, Kim Thomas, executive director of plant services. Ted Gilbert, associate superintendent of district services. Now we'd like to also recognize our business partners who worked with us on this as well. Rick Ayers from Thornton Brothers. Clay Gilbert from Thornton Brothers. Jim Chitten Sr. from Athens Janitor Supply. John Chitten from Athens Janitor Supply. And Kelly Cooper Smith from Granger. And next, Associate Superintendent Sherry Gilbert has a recognition as well.
That's okay. No problem. Good evening. It's my pleasure tonight to be able to recognize one of our own in our systems district office, Ms. Anissa Jimenez. Each year, the Georgia School Public Relations Association recognizes public relations professionals demonstrating exceptional communication skills at their annual conference. The association acknowledges professionals who produce outstanding publications, photography, and electronic media. The program is designed to provide recognition and professional support for those who do great work in communicating with parents, staff, the media, community members, business partners, and other stakeholders. This contest is open to any Georgia school system, post-secondary institution, educational agency, or education-related association. At the 2015 Georgia School Public Relations Association's annual conference, Ms. Jimenez received 6 awards, which is a sweep for us. They are as follows: Best in Category, 2014-2015 Activities Calendar; Gold Award of Excellence, 2014-2015 Activities Calendar; Gold Award of Excellence, 2015 Special Event National Superintendent of the Year Reception; Gold Award of Excellence, Electronic Media, Innovative Digital Learning Environments Video; Gold Award of Excellence, Electronic Media, Martin Luther King Jr. Contest Video; Bronze Award of Merit, Special Purpose Publication, CCSD Promotional Posters. We've always known how talented Ms. Jimenez is, as she displays it each day. She is a perfectionist, and we appreciate that. We depend on her to ensure that CCSD is always presented professionally for our community and other stakeholders. Congratulations and thank you, Ms. Jimenez. We are so very proud of you.
Together we produce the top academic calendar in the state of Georgia.
You know, again, you know, as always, these are just great celebratory moments, and it's nice to have us in the great hall. But to our students and parents, thank you for the support. of our students. And to our employees, you know, what a cadre of awards. And it doesn't come from just one area. We think about this as from public placings to green cleaning, how we roll out other things in our schools. So I'm just really proud of the CCSD. Thank you again for all this.
We have a 10-minute recess, only 10 minutes, and from here, we'll move up to room 66 for the regular board meeting. Thank you for coming.
And the first item of business on our agenda is election of board president and vice president. Mr. Attorney.
Thank you, Mr. President. So you each have two ballots. On the top of them, this is the election. So both of them are going to check election where it says nomination or election. Then one of them, you have president, the other would be for vice president. Write in your name of who you want to vote for, sign it, and print your name. As you remember, we only have one nominee in each category. We have Worthy is our only nominee for president. Sarah Ellis is our only nominee for vice president. And then if you will pass them down this way, we will tally them up. See if we do it right. Unanimous election. Charles Worthy will be the president for the next term, and Sarah Ellis will be vice president for the next term.
Thank you very much. So I'm going to be playing the chair again, so we're going to move on.
Congratulations.
The next item in this have any amendments to the agenda?
President Worthy, I'd like to ask that we amend the agenda to add an executive session for the purpose of evaluation of the superintendent.
Okay, that would be item 19, board members, executive session for the evaluation of the superintendent. You can write that in as item 19. Okay, we'll do that immediately when we finish the agenda. Now,
is because we haven't approved.
You just vote on the agenda as a whole, right, as amended. Okay. Y'all have two separate votes.
Okay, I'm going to call for the adopting of the agenda. I need a motion for that, and that will take care of all of that.
Good.
Got a motion by Ms. Thornton, got a second from Mr. Hyde. All in favor, amending and adopting the agenda. Okay, unanimous vote. Motion passed. Okay, our next item of business is a recognition of visitors. I need to read a statement before I call on the first speaker. Speakers would be limited to three timed minutes. At this point, remarks must be concluded. No speaker shall indulge in personal attacks while speaking. All comments are to be addressed directly to the Board of Education. To protect the privacy of our students, speakers should refrain from identifying specific students by name. Personal concerns may be addressed in writing to the superintendent or the president of the Board of Education. Our first speaker for this evening is Ms. Tommy Farmer, Student Resources.
Thank you.
would just like to say good evening to all of you. And I have several requests this evening. I just stopped by this evening to remind you of a couple of things. We still have this issue of the have and have nots in the school system. I came to tell you there's still some racial and economic discrimination that we need to address. And I came by to ask you to please stop using poverty as an excuse for those very low test scores that appeared on the front page of the paper. But more importantly, I ask you to read an article that was posted in the Washington Post in December, and the title of that article was, "This Superintendent Has Figured Out How to Make School Work for Poor Kids." There were two points that stood out for me, and one of them was urgency. We need to have the same urgency of other people's children as we have of our own children. If we have this urgency, we will not be satisfied with our students receiving computers to take home and they cannot use them. If we have the same urgency, we will not be satisfied with sending our elementary students to McDonald's and community centers and sitting in the lobby of the neighborhood health center to do their homework. If we have the same urgency, we would find the funds to supply all of our students' needs. Now, the next point that was made came in the form of a question. How is it that we are to know the needs of our students and our communities if we're never in those communities? So I ask a question to all of us. Where have you been lately? I also want to encourage the school board to do a study of the correlation between our educationally unarmed students and what is going on in the community. Many of them are being killed. You know what the newspapers say. I just want us to start treating all of our students the way we would like for our children to be treated. We need to level the playing field here in Clarke County for all of our students. A child's education and expectation should not be judged by the zip code. I am going to just stop right here, and I hope that you're listening to me, and I am appealing to the conscience of all of you sitting here. Now, just in closing, I don't know about you, but my God says this, when we do it to the least of them, you do it unto me, and you will reap what you sow. Come on, Clarke County, let's do this urgency in 2016 for all of our students. I stand here as one, but I speak for many. The slogan, proud to be CCSD, I don't think so. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Farmer. Our second speaker for this evening is C. Rhett Jackson, Athletic Opportunity Should Be Tailored to Individual Students. There you are.
Hello, my name is Rhett Jackson, and I have an 11th grader and an 8th grader in Clarke County Schools. And the issue I'd like to talk to you about tonight is not earth-shattering, nor does it affect a lot of students, but I do think it involves an important principle. And the issue specifically is whether 8th graders should be allowed to play junior varsity sports at the high school level if they have the desire and the ability to do so. One of the things I've always appreciated about the Clarke County Schools is that academic programs and opportunities are tailored to the individual student's abilities to the extent that that's practical, whether that's taking AP classes or going to Career Academy or taking double orchestra for your connections classes. We seem to have a principle that your academic opportunities should be tailored to your abilities. I think we should have the same principle for athletic opportunities. Georgia high school sports rules allow 8th graders to play JV sports in high schools. Individual school districts can make their own decision with respect to that. Through this fall, Clarke County allowed 8th graders to play junior varsity sports. Sometime in the last few weeks, a new policy was made without any apparent discussion or notification, and it really surprised my family, And we've come to find out that my eighth grade daughter will not be able to play junior varsity soccer for the high school this spring, which she had been planning to do. I'm very fortunate that my daughter is a straight A student and a very good athlete. She's had the privilege and pleasure of twice running cross country for Clarke Middle School, twice playing on the basketball team for Clarke Middle School, and as a seventh grader playing for the soccer team. While she enjoyed playing soccer in seventh grade, she realized that the level of play in middle school soccer was not a challenge for her. She's been playing competitive soccer since she was 6 years old. She plays on a club team that's in the top 20 in the state. And she realized last year that there just wasn't enough challenge for her in middle school soccer. So she's been planning for the last year to play for the junior varsity at the high school. The coach of the high school has watched her play, knows she's ready, and last week we find out she couldn't do it. She's quite upset. She's not only a smart girl and a good athlete, but she's got a lot of vinegar in her, and I'm catching a lot of heat for this. And I would like to know if this is the policy, why? Because I can't see what the larger point of it is. I would like that this policy be rescinded until it can be discussed with the people that it's affecting. Again, I would just implore us to allow the same principle that applies to academic programs to apply to the athletic programs. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Jackson. Okay, we're going to go ahead and move the agenda. Dr. LaNue, we're down to item A, superintendent's report.
Superintendent's report. First, I'd like to introduce our new director of director of planning. It's part of our students be able to go on because of SB 132 to go on to college for free. And that's a great opportunity for our students. So Lawrence, where you're here.
Right.
There you are. So I just want to say Lawrence's background has been quite impressive, and he's worked with students at Clarke Central, and now he's working with students at Cedar Shoals. But I can say without a doubt that I couldn't be more pleased with Lawrence's work and his connections with children and young adults and piquing their interest to really push them academically. So I asked him to please talk a little bit about who he is and sort of where are we at this point with your perception to where we're going.
Well, thank you so much for having me this evening. Well, first of all, thank you so much again for having me. I'm very excited to say that I think the current academy, we're in a booming period right now. A lot of students and parents have been emailing and calling about the opportunities we're offering. We've increased our pathways. We've added three more to here at the current academy. We're actually targeting 7 at the Athens Tech main campus that our students will be able to take advantage of. And so I think it's a really exciting time to be a dual enrolled student, to really be a move on ready student. And so I think the language is starting to be heard within the high schools. Principals are starting to have students ask them questions about it. And so it's really great to see that our students are really seeing how this opportunity can help take them even further. We're going to be doing grade wide testing soon. And so we're actually offering test prep here at the Career Academy, not just for the ASET, but for the SAT and ACT. So we expect that we have 49 students already registered to come early Saturday morning. We're hoping that number will increase every month. We hope that we actually run out of space and we have to actually find new teachers and tutors to help to teach our students. So that's kind of our report for the evening. If you have any questions, feel free.
So we're talking test prep for the SAT and
ACT and the ASET.
Okay, and the ASET is for
Athens
Tech. And we have how many students involved in that particular prep?
I work with Madison County High School as well as Forsyth County. Uh-huh. We actually work together to create a very specific curriculum that you actually target the content areas from all three exams into one test prep program. So you actually come, and even if you're preparing for ACT, SAT, or ASET, you're actually getting content material from all three in one prep class.
Okay, and is that's open to any Clarke County student?
Yes.
As well as those other two counties?
Right. Well, the other two counties don't want to come here, though. So.
Oh, okay.
They have their own version.
I gotcha.
Georgia is a SAT state, but I notice each year seemingly the ACT is just sort of creeping up there. Any idea approximately how many students are going to be taking the ACT?
Approximately no, but I will say that on our registration page for the students, we actually asked the question, which test are you preparing for? And the ACT has come up more than the SAT. We're actually at like 64% for the ACT, the remainder is for the SAT. So no clue why that's the case, why there's a shift towards ACT. It may be because there has been a change with the College Board for the new SAT test coming out, especially with the new one being launched in March of this year. It also could be that the ACT does tend to be more content-based based off of what you learned in high school curriculum versus it being an aptitude test. So students as well, if you do well in your classes, you would tend to do better on the ACT than your aptitude for the SAT.
Yeah, I read an article in the newspaper, I don't know, sometime last year, but anyway, I was just wondering whether Georgia is moving toward the ACT rather than the SAT. That's why I asked the question.
So besides, you know, the test prep, you're also involved in dual enrollment with Athens Tech and UGA, or specifically Athens Tech?
With Athens Tech, UGA, University of North Georgia, and Piedmont College. And so it's not just, I mean, Athens Tech for sure here, because most of our, all of our classes here are taught by Athens Tech instructors.
Right.
But definitely UGA, I mean, they do require that students have 3.9 or 1400 SAT scores. But we have students who have to meet those requirements, who are very interested in going to UGA. So it's not just Career Academy. Part of being the director of college career planning is more than just focusing just on this building, but also seeing what can we do in our middle schools and high schools to increase that college-going culture. And part of that is looking at UGA and North Georgia and Piedmont and Emanuel, you know, because we have great schools and great colleges and universities around this area. So it's definitely more than just Athens Tech.
So is your office based at Cedar Shoals? Is that?
No, I'm actually right here.
So it's right here. So what's your connection to like Cedar Shoals and Clarke Central?
Basically, I work pretty heavily with administration there and the counseling offices, since the counselors tend to be, I call them the gatekeepers, is kind of the nickname for them, because they tend to be the ones that's kind of the last line of defense for the students to really decide, do you want to use Move Already and dual enroll, or do you want to stay within the high school setting to finish out your junior and senior year. So I tend to be in high schools quite a bit. Looking forward around April, I do plan on going to the middle schools, because looking at this plan of trying to really build this college-going culture, which for me, I think, really means getting that conversation started, making where students can start talking to their teachers about it, their college experience. So I've talked to a lot of students about how do you feel about your teachers, and a lot of students also forget that the teacher went to college. I mean, I took a survey, and raise your hand if you think your teacher went to college, and half of them kind of let their hands down. It's like, you know, everybody that teaches you has a bachelor's degree. but understanding and realizing that also made it seem that, well, you have this resource here right in front of you that you see every day of the week. Why can't there be a way that you can say, well, can you tell me more about your experience at UGA or Georgia State, or maybe you went to school at Clarke Central, their drama teacher, Ms. Anderson, went to college in Canada. So a lot of students, they hear that, like, well, what would that like to go out of a country for your college? And so it's about getting that conversation started and then building that culture, and slowly I think families will feel more, and we'll see that culture just start to grow within our schools.
Great.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for all you do. And next, something, well, really a little bit different, was Dr. Donovan here. There you are. Real excited. I think you're going to see that she is, and I wanted to talk to the board if there are any questions. And this is really about a dual immersion program. And I think a lot of times people ask in different districts, do you have a dual immersion program? What does that look like? And this is a real grassroots effort from Oglethorpe. I think it's kind of a precursor to a charter system where schools begin to take on their, you know, sort of some sort of shape or flavor. I think this is the kinds of innovations you'll see. So I've asked Dr. Dunn to talk about that with you today, so you better understand, ask any questions of what that means, because our goal is to begin this next year.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having me. I will try to contain my excitement and passion while I'm here, because this is something that I hope at the end that you'll find it equally as exciting.
I want to make just a small comment, and
okay.
I know you'll chuckle.
Okay.
If you don't know Dr. Dunn, she's pretty clear. If she has her mind set up, she does her homework. So she said, when she came into my office, I said, after she was done, I think I would have been better off throwing myself in front of a bus. You know what I'm saying? That would have been safer. It's garlic, yes.
And I actually take that as a compliment.
It is. I want you to know that it is a compliment, because of her thoroughness and her passion, and that's why. And when she gets it. So thank you.
Thank you.
Sorry, I didn't want to come to your expense, but that tells your passion.
That's true. The first thing I want you to know about this program is it will meet the needs of all children. It doesn't matter if they're Hispanic, Latino, African American, Caucasian, or any other type of student. The most important thing to know is that, first of all, the program I'd like to build is for all children. So what is dual language? Dual language programs educate English learners and native English learners and speakers together. Students who participate in dual language immersion receive instruction in two languages to become bilingual, biliterate, and to develop the cultural competency to succeed in a global society. Why should we have a program like this in our schools? the research shows a couple of very important things. First of all, children who participate in a bilingual program have increased attention control. They have better memory. They have superior problem-solving skills. They have enhanced understanding of their primary language, and they have greater cognitive flexibility. What would a curriculum look like in a school that had a dual immersion program? English learners need enriched, sustained forms of instruction that allow them to receive support in their first language while learning a second language. Dual language programs offer English learners a mainstream curriculum, which leads to full English proficiency and curriculum mastery, with instruction provided by monolingual and multilingual teachers. At Oglethorpe, we have a couple of goals, the first one being to develop bilingual and biliterate children using the K-5 model. A secondary goal that we have is that we would implement a dual language immersion program to align with the Clarke County School District mission and vision for the International Baccalaureate program in grades 6 through 12 in collaboration with the Clarke County School District Middle and high school instructional leaders. The model that we would like to use as we begin our program will be the 80-20 model, which calls for at least 80% of the school day to be taught and spent in learning Spanish, learning about using Georgia Standards of Excellence and the Georgia Performance Standards of Modern Language in Spanish. Dual language teachers will teach language arts and literacy skills for 20% of the day in English. By high school graduation, participating students will have acquired solid bilingual and bilateral skills. We'd like to start our implementation in August of 2016 with two kindergarten classes. As the model expands, year one, which would be this next school year, two kindergarten classes using an 80-20 model. Year two of the program, we would add on first grade with that same 80-20 model. Year three, we would add up to second grade using the 80-20 model. And then in grades 3 through 5, for the next 3 years, years 4 through 6, we would move to a 50-50 model, where 50% of the day is taught in Spanish and 50% of the day taught in English. And the primary reason for switching from an 80-20 model to a 50-50 model is that of the state requirements of testing. Our children are not allowed to be tested in Spanish right now. I think it will change, but for now they must be tested in English, and so we'll prepare them 3rd through 5th grade in using the 50-50 model. Who will be eligible to participate in this program? Enrollment in the dual language immersion program will be open to students within the Oglethorpe neighborhood zone. If more students from the attendance zone apply than there are spaces available, then a lottery will be held to determine enrollment. Our enrollment registration would begin on Tuesday, January 19th, and we will keep an open enrollment until May 2nd. Of 2016, and that will let us know how many students we had at that time. We have a 5-year, it's really a 6-year implementation plan. For this next school year, starting in kindergarten, and then as I mentioned, each year we would phase in a grade level. So it would take us 6 years to complete the implementation, and over the course of the 6 years, we would then begin our work with middle schools and high schools to help them start a dual enrollment program there that will mesh with IB program. We have quite a few community partners. What's exciting about this is I didn't actually call them, they called me. Somehow the word got out that we were looking at starting a dual language program, and these three people on this list from UGA who have various roles actually contacted me and said, I hear something. And so we've been able to sit down and talk about dual language. They are on board and ready to assist us in any way that we need to implement this program. We also have the State Department person, Mikhail. Taylor Klosnicks, who is also joined us in partnering to build the program, because there are no programs currently outside the Atlanta area. And then we are working closely with the Director of World Language in Gwinnett County, and also not on this list, working with the Director of World Language in Hall County. So I feel really great about the fact that I already have people in our community, not just school community, but our larger community, that would like to join us in helping start this program.
Okay. So I'll stop there. And again, I want to add certainly for Dr. Dunn, because as soon as you heard this, you went out to a conference, really began to do the research behind what this would do. And I have the same thing you met with me. Your research is really clear. And the data is really clear. Certainly work with your school and present that, and this is what that school wants. So it's all the dynamics around the neighborhood pieces begin to find what they think is important in their neighborhood. So I'll stop there maybe and you can ask questions.
My question is, fantastic program. Is you're adding additional grades that were not, that didn't start out with this program? Or when you say add two classrooms in the second or whatever grade, are these kids that were not in the prior year's program, or how is that working?
So the plan will be that we'll start in kindergarten of this next school year. I think that maybe there's two parts to that. One, am I adding additional classrooms or adding additional staff? And the answer is no. And the reason that is another reason why this program is very cost efficient, is because I did not want to start anything using soft money where 2 or 3 years down the road, the program folded because I didn't have the money to keep it going. So my proposal to Dr. Lemieux was, I can make this work using state funding with FTE, so that every year I have what I need for staff, and I'm not asking the district to provide for me. I'm able to sustain that within the building. The second part of that is for children, if they are ahead of this kindergarten year, they simply miss out on the opportunity, which is very sad. However, if you're a kindergartner, a rising kindergartner, and behind that, you are in for a wonderful opportunity, because we are setting you up. I don't know where else in our community you can send your child to a school and create an environment where you can have those children learn two languages and to become biliterate, and it absolutely costs you nothing. So what an opportunity for our community and our families to be able to do this. And again, I want to make sure everyone understands, this is not just for our Latino population, our Hispanic population, this is for all children. That's the beauty.
So I'm not totally clear here. So the first year that you roll out is going to be kindergarten only.
Yes, ma'am.
And then the next year will be kindergarten and first grade.
Yes.
So it is in succession.
That's
so
right.
So the same children will be in this program for these 6 years.
Yes, that's correct.
I think that's the question I was trying to ask.
Sorry.
And I apologize for sending y'all down that
road. Because I would be so excited to talk about everything I know so far, but you do not have time for me to do that.
Yeah, okay.
And I have just enough information to be completely dangerous.
Okay, thank you.
I have a question. So you have maybe, what, 4 kindergarten classes?
I do.
So is it all kindergarten
classes? It will be 2 of those.
2 of those.
So I'll have two dual language classrooms and 2 traditional classrooms.
Okay. And then you mentioned the word lottery.
So the way that we've planned ahead is that I need 44 children is what I need, is what I want. And I think I'm not going to have a problem with that. But if any number over 44 would put us in a lottery situation. If I have 44 or less, everybody's in the program. No question. If I have 60 children, then it will force us to go to a lottery situation where we will then use the same process as pre-K uses to determine who is into the program, because it eliminates things like employees' children and any conflict there, or a parent has a set of twins and one gets in and one doesn't. It eliminates all of those issues, so it's very fair and it's very equal for everyone that's involved. So the magic number, I'm hoping for 44, so that I don't have that issue. But on the flip side of that, if I have 70, that would be fabulous too, because it will help, you know, help everyone in the community understand it's, people want it. I anticipate a waiting list after this year, after this first year of implementation.
Did you do like surveys or something within the parents, or, I mean, what's that response in terms of PTOs, conversations, whatever?
So for me, and maybe it's because I'm old now, so I wanted to start at the top. I needed to understand that our district, Dr. Lemieux, was, this is something that he felt was worthwhile. I wanted to start there. So I didn't start with parents this time. I started there because one request I had was, can you help me remove barriers? Because I know there are barriers out there. And if I can have your support, then I can move and I can do all sorts of other things as long as I know I'm supported from the top. So when he was then run over by the bus, then I was like, okay. So then I went to our leadership team and I went there. After I went there, I went to our PTO board. After I went there, I went to our parents in general. And so I did all of that, but I layered it a little bit different. And last night, let me just say that last night we had our first meeting, because our core group of people we'd like to recruit from are our current pre-K students. Those are the students I'd love to just move right in. There happen to be 44 of them. I'd love to move them in. So we had a parent meeting last night, and I had 28 people attend, and 9 people enrolled. So just from one meeting, I haven't done anything else yet. That tells me that I can make this happen. And our community, the beauty of that meeting were the Hispanic families and the non-Hispanic families talking about this together and dialoguing together, and it happening both in English and Spanish. And this is what I'm trying to create, a community where all of this can happen and we can all respect each other in our different cultures. That was a really long answer to your question. Yes, ma'am. I see.
What, I mean, I think it's a great program. I'm not trying to put a cold or anything. I'm just curious. What is the plan for, like, kids moving out and then filling spots in first or second or third or fourth or fifth grade? Or, I think the likelihood of all 44 staying and over for the duration of their elementary careers, you know, it's probably... Kids move.
Yes, you
know,
of course.
So what is the...
So we're going to follow the research down that path.
Okay.
And the research down that path says a native speaker, for example, can enter the program at any time up to second grade. But after second grade, the foundation that you built, they haven't been there, you cannot insert them at grade 3 or grade 4 or grade 5. Because you've switched from that model of 80-20 to 50-50, they don't have enough foundation.
Right.
So we will not accept any, you have to be a native speaker to be accepted in after kindergarten. If you're not a native speaker, you cannot be accepted in. Now, the balance that we will provide for this first year is a 50-50 balance. So half of those children will be English speakers, native, and the other half will be native Spanish speakers. And we have to build it like that so that each of them have peer groups in terms of their work. So that is the plan up to second grade. The reason that we're starting with 2 kindergarten classes is just what you talk about, the attrition issue. That's why at first I thought, well, let's just start with 1 class, let's start slow, let's make sure we get it right, because part of this is we have to get it really right, if we get it really right. But then I thought, if I only have 22 kids and 9 of those move, I don't have enough for first grade. So that's what's pushing me in the direction of starting with 2. That's a sort of a safeguard that if they move, I will still be able to move forward. Because what I think is going to happen is after this first year and our community hears about it, I think I'm going to have a lottery problem, because I think it's going to be very hard.
And then I have one more question about teacher recruitment, teachers who are prepared to teach in a dual immersion classroom.
So I've bitten off more than just working on an elementary problem. I'm now working with people at the university level and at the state level, because I've helped them understand that in a university town, a pipeline should be developed for teachers. And what we currently have in this town is teachers are not certified to teach in dual language, but that can very easily change at the university level with a little bit of push. And so I'm pushing a little that they begin that work, such as we have ESOL endorsements and gifted endorsements, a dual language endorsement should be added. Mm-hmm. So I'm pushing that way as I'm working with university people. At the same time, at the state level, Georgia is working on a dual language seal for the diploma. So I'm starting to work with those people, and it's a small group because right now the only schools doing this are in the Atlanta area. So I'm starting to collaborate with those people and help them understand the importance of putting this on a diploma. Because what we know this year in 2015-16 is a student that is in a dual language program, kindergarten through 12th grade, and graduates, economically speaking, they have the earning potential of a minimum of $7,000 more per year than their counterpart that is just an English speaker. If they further that and go into college and finish college with that, economically speaking, minimally $15,000 or more. So what we should be also talking about is the global and economic impact of a program like this. The other statistic is that in 2030, the population of which we live, 65% of our population will be native speakers of Spanish. And so what are we going to do with those children? How are we going to educate those children to be in our workforce? So that's a whole nother piece, a whole nother layer of that. I'm sorry, another long answer. But as you can see, there are so many facets of this. It's not just about a little elementary school creating a little kindergarten class that will do a little something different. It's really about an impact of an elementary school starting a program with a five-year plan that will then impact middle school, high school, and college. The answer to certification is that currently, to do this work, a teacher only has to have an early childhood education degree because there is nothing else for them. So to hire this person, I will follow the research there as well, and I will hire a native speaker of Spanish with an early childhood education degree to start the program. It's a little like finding a needle in a haystack, but one of those barriers that I talked to Dr. Lemieux about was, I need to post this job early. Dr. Freeman, knocked their doors. So that job has been posted, and I have 10 applicants already.
Wow. And so in 6 years, you'll need 12.
Yes. Yes. That's the math. Yes.
She will get 12.
That's the math, yeah. It's very frightening if you think about it, sometimes whole picture like that. So I do think about that, and I do have that plan. But what I'm trying to focus on right now is I need two. For 2016, I need two. And that'll give me, I'll buy some more time, and I'll post in October next year, and I'll find some more. I've got to beat out those people in Atlanta. I've got to encourage people to come here, not there, for all sorts of reasons. So.
Yes.
Or stay here and not go there. To get them to stay here, we need that university piece. We need to add that to our students' work. We need to add that, offer that endorsement.
Well, Dr. Don, I want to thank you for having such vision on that. Congratulations on that.
Thank
because
you.
It's going to impact all three levels.
Yes.
Actually,
yes.
Four, because you mentioned college too. The dual. Yes.
That's great.
It's very exciting. Thank you for having me.
Great, thank Dr. Dunn. Thank you. Great job. Very exciting.
Very exciting. Well, that's my report. See you. Okay, let's keep it moving. Board reports. The Spain, GSBA?
Good. I have an excellent report.
All right.
A few years ago, we put an addition on to our headquarters. In Lawrenceville, 180 school district participated, and we paid it off last month. We don't owe a dime from that building. And I was the inspector of that building, and it is built to last. I told everybody in Gwinnett County, if you have a tornado, come to GSBA headquarters, because that building is built. And the peculiar thing about it, I would go up there every week. And then the executive director, she would get with the contractor and be asked the contractor questions and said, we need to do this, we need to do that. And so every week he would have a whole list of things he needed to do. So at the ribbon cutting ceremony, he introduced me as the inspector for her, who working on that building. It's fine too. The other thing that I want to say is that we had a wonderful conference this year. It's always at the moment of meditation, get off to a rigorous hallelujah shout, we have a good conference. And we had a good conference this year. And many of the board members and superintendents, they saw Dr. Ledoux's name on the program. They said, so he's coming to check on you, Payne. Go make sure that you attended this conference. I said, no, he's coming to inform you of his way of educating children. And so all of the speakers, and we had 25% more exhibitors this year. And we had 40% more people who joining GSB as an alternate, and they are supporting us financially. And so that was great. So we had just a great conference. And then the reason I didn't report last week, I wanted to get the survey out. We had a survey, and I wanted to see what the people were saying about Dr. Liu's address. And so the results came in. Only 7 people didn't give him a high rating. And they were ticked off because the state is not paying them enough money and they cannot do some of the things that we are doing. And I said, that's not Dr. Liu's fault. I said, you need to see your legislature and get with them, because as I tell you all the time, many of the small districts are suffering. They cannot initiate the program, they cannot get the enjoyment, but still. And Dr. Liu, I appreciate that article that you put in the paper telling everybody, they ought to be proud of the schools in Georgia, because all of them are making progress. And the small ones, those that are not receiving money from industry and other organizations, but they're still closing the achievement gap, and they're still educating children. So this is a good thing. And Dr. Liu, let me just say it to you personally. One of the things that I was so pleased with when I read the article in the paper, where you was and the University of Georgia were working together to make sure that we could get them to help us in our school district. This is one of the things that I've been advocating ever since I've been on the board, because when many years ago, Dr. Tom Upchurch, in his school district, he was partnering with North Georgia College, and he had 2 grant writers. And they were bringing in enough money, and along with North Georgia College, they were writing grants, and he was able to provide computers for all of his high school students and all the middle school students. And he had more money than he needed. And one of the things that I wanted to see happen was that we partnered with the University of Georgia, and Dr. Liu, you have done that. And what a lot of people don't understand is the fact that we would have better teachers in the state of Georgia and all over America that comes in the classroom the first year and not wait till the last year and do that student teaching and find out that this is not the field I want to be in. So they come in the first year, the second year, the third year, the fourth year, and they don't like to get out. And we don't need them in the classroom. We need dedicated teachers in the classroom to motivate, inspire, and move our children forward. And this is what's happening now. With working with the University of Georgia. And Dr. Liu, I appreciate my hats off to you, because this will benefit all the children in the state of Georgia. And when these teachers leave the state of Georgia, it will benefit all the children wherever they go. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mr. President. Finance Committee?
I know, report. I will say that I did see in the minutes of the state board meeting that the charter school was approved.
Should have said that. Thank you. Our extension of the 1-year application for the Career Academy charter has been approved. Government Relations Committee?
I'm just going to ask everyone to look in at your the legislator priorities that was passed out. We presented this when we met with our delegation Dr. Lindsay, did you want to address?
Sure. Let me sort of explain, or we can do it probably because it's an action item.
Then I'll just go with my report.
How would that be? Because if I leave that for then, that would create content.
And one of the things, when we met earlier this week, we were talking about all of the board being more involved. We had some great conversation and dialogue last year, and we're going to try to look at ways, I think, that we can make sure all of the board members are participating. I know coming at, is it 8 o'clock, 8:30?
8:30.
On a Tuesday may be difficult on people's schedules, but we really want to try to get the input and get all of the board members engaged. And one thing that I really am feeling very strongly about, there seems to be a group of people that know what's going on politically, and there's another group of people that are trying to figure it out. And I think one of the things that I really want to push for is that we reach across this town or this area, at least give the people a doorway or an avenue that they can know what's going on politically. We get blamed for a lot of things, and they're not our fault because it's legislatively led, but we really need to use our resources and our contacts to casually talk about things that are affecting our community statewide. So it leads into, you got this pretty little brochure flyer. There's going to be a form that we are, the Clarke County School District is co-sponsoring. It's sponsored by Alpha Phi Alpha. And we're going to have some dialogue on Saturday at 10 o'clock at the library. And then I think there's another event that's also going to come be available to the community. So I think we are growing. I think we did a great job last year. We got information. Now we've got to figure out how to best use this information. And that, obviously, that from Dr. Lindsay could move into what we discussed.
Sure. Policy.
No report.
Property. They are meeting.
On the 26th.
Okay.
I have a meeting on the 26th. It's a very important property meeting, and I will not be able to go out and attend the meeting that I was scheduled to meet. I told you that I could meet. So I need somebody to fill in me, and I'll fill in you.
I'm the vice chair, so I'll be there.
Okay. Thank you.
Let me confirm real quick.
Is this for Pat?
Sorry. You tell me one more time what
I
you
think you wanted to go to property. I think you were scheduled, Mr. Payne, to go to PAB.
But
we're looking for someone to rotate and just switch from for PAB.
Yeah.
So he needs somebody to do PAB.
Do
for
PAB.
Got it. I'll be at property. Sorry.
Okay.
I'll be at property also.
Yeah.
So.
Okay.
Where is
PAB? To either Gaines or Alice.
Gaines.
To East Side.
5:30.
Actually,
6:30.
6:30. Yeah, we don't do 6:30.
What day is that? On Tuesday.
You can't do it, Linda.
It's on Tuesday.
Let me double check. What's
Friday? Is Tuesday the 26th.
Yeah, 26th.
That's what we're saying, yeah.
And that's when that's going to be
out. PAB's always on Monday.
Yeah,
PAB's usually
on the 20th. Yeah, PAB's on Monday. And property.
You think it's going to be okay?
Yeah, it'll be okay.
Monday,
it's a Monday.
Oh, it's on the 25th.
Yeah. So you got to do both.
Okay.
I'm trying to save you, Linda. I'm thinking about class.
Yeah. Okay. Let me just clear that up. We're okay with property and we're okay with PAB. There's two different dates.
Yes. Yeah,
got it. Okay. All right. Okay, go to F. Since there's no policy discussions, it goes to action items.
Yeah, okay, action items, we have the minutes for a regular meeting on December the 10th. Of course, you reviewed those, and I entertain a motion for approval. Approved by Mr. Payne, got a second from Ms. Davis. Any questions pertaining to the minutes? Any questions pertaining to the minutes? All in favor? Thank you very much, motion. passed unanimously.
Recommend approval of the financial report, November 2015.
And the motion from the superintendent on the financial report, we talked about this in the finance meeting last Thursday. Okay, need a motion on that? Moved by Ms. Williams. Got a second from you, Mr. Huff. I see your hand. Second from Mr. Huff. Okay, any questions pertaining to the financial report? Any questions? All in favor? Thank you very much.
Okay. Recommend approval of the policies as listed.
Okay, all of these policies that are listed here, recommendations from the superintendent, need a motion on that? Moved by Ms. Davis, got a second from Mr. Payne. Any questions pertaining to these policies? Any questions? All in favor?
And at this point, just note there will be rescind, that will be regulation cases.
Yes.
Okay.
We don't throw those anyway.
Recommend approval of the consent agenda.
Okay, the consent agenda by Ms. Thornton, seconded by Mr. Payne. All in favor? Thank you. Motion passed.
At this point, we'll be going to the program of study. Dr. Tavernier, if there's a whole list of any questions, what we did is we just highlight those changes in the program of studies. Again, I want to just go back through with our program of studies. This has been about a four-year period where we started with our high schools. I think, Mark, I lose track of time, 4 years ago, we brought everyone together. So we have alignment with numbers, courses, in our high schools. We did not have that 6 or 7 years ago. And what we did is we really moved out courses that weren't enrolled. And so the program of studies has been a really strong document. And then Anissa has been working to make sure we put it out in print and of course online. So what we're gonna do today, because it takes quite a bit of formatting and it just compresses our time, is Dr. Tavernier, you've seen the changes, but I thought I could just certainly highlight what we think are the major changes other than just some editing.
Sure, the major changes, this is in your packet, on page 43, they're right there on the screen. The main one was to kind of put back some testing language and change them, and we had to take out last year because of the change to milestones. So, simple things like changing the name of the test. Also, elimination of all reference to Georgia High School graduation test requirements. So, we had to just get a little bit of the testing and testing requirements. Our math courses that finally transitioned, again, the final transition over to Georgia Standards for Excellence takes place next year with the fourth year math courses. All of our students who have a block schedule at some point in time are now graduated or gone, except for a couple, and we were able to eliminate and compress anything related with levels 5, 6, 7, 8 and holdovers from the block, so that collapsed some of our course offerings as well. And the most significant changes were related to the inclusion, and we've talked about this with you, of the new move-up and ready requirements and guidelines, and the kind of revision and addition of several pathways, which were also in the packet. I'll just kind of highlight this briefly. One is that we're going to include a high school culinary arts pathway that will be offered here at the Career Academy instead of the current college level one. And then, as you see at the bottom of the screen, we've done a little bit of revision of the pathways that we're going to offer here, including, because of Senate Bill 2, the actual offering of an associate's degree in business management, and we'll be offering that right here at the Career Academy, along with 8 different technical certificates programs.
And I just expand a little bit, just thank the works of Dr. Tavernier and some others. We're putting forth, and you see a job description in your packet, something really different. We've been known to break ranks, and so the culinary program we won't have offered through Athens Tech. It was very low enrolled. So we've been working with Hugh Atchison and others in town to look at this really differently. So, and Paula Farmer. So what we're doing at this point in time is we need the kitchen to cook for early learning and for this center. So what we're doing, we will have that Paula Farmer cooking with her staff starting at 6. But she's willing, we're gonna work with and hire a position called a culinary arts. It's a director chef. And we're gonna use this really as a test kitchen. So that we will get kids now over that are from high school, that are going to be working right alongside with our food prep. We have visions of creating a large prep area, right? Because the different mode is that you ought to be preparing and moving food out. So we can create and prepare, and then our kids will learn the skills that way, and then also they can do special events. And we're even looking in the job description that we want to open the cafe as an entrepreneurial profit sharing, so we get a business model with kids. And so it's a really, you get a dynamic person, and it's really, really different. And what's really good, Mark, Dr. Tavernier, is through the e-portfolio, and maybe you can explain what that is, sort of a new way we do,
articulate.
Thank you.
In the past, for kids to, or for us to be able to articulate credit, where kids could earn high school and college credit concurrently, had to be a lot of formalized agreements with the technical college system. And so through a new partnership with the technical college system at Athens Tech, we're going to be able to use a system next year called e-portfolio, where the technical college will identify 6 to 8 key competencies that are part of their college course, and if students upload and demonstrate mastery of those concepts, they will be able to earn credit both as a high school student and a college student concurrently. So it's pretty exciting. It's a new thing we're going to be able to do for the first time next year, and really plan to do it in the majority of our high school applicant courses.
Well, thanks, Richard Weber, but that's that call on your side.
The rest of this is that, as we mentioned, there will now be three high school pathways offered right here at the Career Academy. The AV technology and film, which we have offered in the past and we hope to bring back again. The healthcare support services, which has always been here in the culinary. And then at our home high schools, just for informational purposes, there are 5 career pathways, 4 at both high schools plus automotive. So Ag Science, Business Management, Administration, Graphic Arts, and ROTC are at both high schools, and then Cedar has their automotive repair piece. And then because of Obama already, and you got to meet Lawrence, but he and I spent a lot of time working with Athens Tech staff, because students can go on to the main campus of not just Athens Tech, but any campus really where they're admitted to take college coursework. And so Athens Tech, we really felt like we needed to target some specific pathways over there that our students had expressed interest in. And Athens Tech is going to tailor the schedules of those courses to our schedule, and we can provide transportation over to Athens Tech for them. And so while on one hand, kids really can take anything that Athens Tech offers at any time they want to do it during the school day, these targeted pathways are ones that our kids are interested in, or have expressed interest in, and we're going to work with the staff there to target schedules for. And so there are 8 pathways there. One is a diploma program in auto collision technician. 6 of them are technical certificates, and 1 is an associate's degree program.
Could you explain so the board would know what those 3 mean in terms of courses?
Sure. A technical certificate is basically where students take 3 or 4 courses in a particular pathway, for want of a better word. They take an exam, an industry credential exam, and they pass it, they get an industry credential. So I'm credentialed in. An associate's degree is just a traditional kind of a 4-year degree. A diploma is basically it's the technical kind of courses without the academic ones. We get a diploma versus a degree.
And we know just sort of a lot of information brought back and tailored back to the to SB 132, SB 2, which is our kids can go to move on when ready. That students may move on when ready actually by 14, even though we're saying they may explain what the requirements would be, you know, in terms of 2 second certificates.
So they choose the Senate bill 2 option, correct? They get 2 technical certificates of credit in the same pathway, or a diploma, or a degree, plus take 8 high school core courses. They also earn a high school diploma.
Dr. New, y'all were moving so fast in the culinary department. I didn't get a chance to ask my question, sir. This is a very good department. And if you manage it right and train those young people to how to really cook good food, you can sell it. I mean, you can sell it. And you need to have some money coming in so you can buy the raw material. And what's wrong with having a cafe or something that people could come here and get a meal? I mean, turn out a good cook, let me tell you, people go for miles and miles. I go way down in South Georgia every Sunday to get a good meal.
Well, we hope to have every one of them be able to do that.
Yeah. There you go. Dr. Lanou, the other thing is, Clarke Middle School. They open up a garden over there. They sell it. I go over there two or three times a week and buy vegetables and whatever they have, and they're making money. They're making money over there. Good food.
I want to take your food, Mr. Penny.
Well, the pathways that are actually offered on the campus, about how many students are on the campus going actually?
We don't do registration until the end of February. So we're just going to get the program.
Well, how many are on campus here?
No, I was, like, he answered me.
Dr. Tavernier, with the courses that I'm looking at here, with pathway, technical certificates, and you mentioned taking the test, if that's the same as, if you pass the test, is that the same as that they are industry certified in that particular area?
Yes.
Okay.
Mr. Wood.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Dr. Tavernier, in terms of deciding, you know, what the program of study will be at the Career Academy next year, you're obviously looking at numbers from this year. Do you have, because I know about 6 months ago, you know, you gave us, you know, in terms of what the career pathways, you know, what kids have expressed interest in. In terms of numbers, like, let's say, for instance, just for the sake of discussion, early college essentials. You've got that this year, you're going to have it next year. So how many students would it take to keep that program active?
Here at the Career Academy?
Right.
You know, we've been pretty flexible with that. Dr. Lanou and I, we talk about that actually a lot, working through the enrollment period. And, you know, we've carried courses with
five or six
students even in them, because we felt like it was important and actually pretty cost effective to do so. But, you know, some of our early college essentials courses we have two sections of them, which means there could be over 40 kids in them.
And I think what's really important to know is that this year we don't pay for them.
Right.
I mean, the part that we are very flexible, even our lower numbers, is that Athens Tech absorbed some of that cost as part of our partnership, because we felt we wanted to get it together. But now in our contract right now is all those courses, we don't pay any money for them.
Okay.
Those are all paid by the state. The only agreements that we have made, that if we had some kids that really need something and it was below a cap, we would help fill that if we felt that course really needed to finish those kids off.
The target is 12.
In terms of the high school pathways that are taught over here, they're offered here at the I'm talking about culinary arts for next year, the audio and visual technology.
For next year.
So that's not, none of these are taught this year.
These are the healthcare. Next year's program studies.
Okay, so.
The healthcare is here this
year. The healthcare is here this year. Now, I just want to make sure those students, they are not dual enrolled in terms of Athens Tech.
Correct.
Okay, so they're, so what, in terms of the, of expanding this particular, these particular pathways, high school pathways taught over here, how are you making that determination what to offer? Is it space? Is it interest? At the high school level?
Mr. Harris, you know, he met earlier, he's done a really, really good job of connecting with the students here and at the home high schools, and part of that's been a survey, interest survey, so he really was the one that identified these and really went after getting them developed and working with Athens Tech.
So, I mean, in other words, because one of my concerns was, has always been what's being offered at the home school, but if I kind of give up that coast and look at it in terms of expanding opportunities here at the Career Academy with these other options for high school students to come over here and be on a pathway and not be dual enrolled, that's another way to kind of get at the same thing.
Sure, and again, I want to, as I said before, one of the pieces with our Athens Tech that's important is we use them because they're the ones that understand what the jobs are.
Right.
Mm-hmm. We thought we did, but they do. I think, and even talking with the Lieutenant Governor's office, there's a large push that our kids need to have at least some college credit to be competitive.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And for us not to do that would be problematic. So what this allows us with ePortfolio, we can get kids in the high school piece, and then they can pick and choose on their level of competency and comfort and able to get the ePortfolio. But I would say right now our goal ought to be to get kids into a tech certificate program, because when we looked at the CTA pathways before, we only had 10 kids that could even pass the test. So, and then those markets were not there. So we work with Athens Tech, we look at our pathways, we decide sort of our curriculum, there's kids' interest, and we're looking much better doing this blended way to do things.
You got one last question, Dr. Lanou and Dr. Tavernier. In terms of enrollment, I think you said at the beginning of the year that our enrollment jumped from something like 130 at the Career Academy to like 150.
About 150.
Were we able to keep those students?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. Yeah,
let me say something in conjunction with what Mr. Davis is saying, also what you said, Dr. Lanou. When you're dealing with high school students, especially when you're dealing with them in terms of elective courses, you're going to have to go beyond leaving it to them in terms of what they're interested in. Dr. Lanou mentioned a piece a few minutes ago with Athens Tech, where the jobs are, how much money they're going to make. Those are the kinds of things that you got to put out there to high school students, because at one time we had all of these scores, well, not the same courses, but the vocational, career, technical ed departments at both high schools, and there were some teachers who lost the job. Simply because of the fact that no one signed up for it. You got to promote your program, and you got to put it out there in terms of to these young people, like I said, far beyond interest now. You know, when you mention money, jobs, and those kinds of things, et cetera, you're going to get the interest of high school students.
We do think that the Great Promise Partnership, where we have got the coordinator. We also believe to make some connection that when kids go into job settings, that will pique an interest, so then reconnect them back into either a high school or a college pathway. So we're trying to say, if we've got 30 or 40 people in manufacturing, that's going to create either boost our mechatronics program, or it's going to boost probably a logistics program. I mean, so we're really, really hoping if we don't start with a course end, let's start with the jobs end. And then get people excited to come back into a pathway. I mean, that's kind of that. Because it's not working just saying sign up. That's not good.
So you were saying, I'm thinking of Career Academy as really being an opportunity for 11th and 12th graders. But you said something about move on when ready and 14-year-olds. Can you elaborate on that?
Sure. The law allows any high school student to move on to college if they meet the admission requirements. I mean, we've talked a good bit about that, and that's not really denied, but that was in 14, 15, so on. We're going to focus on 11th and 12th graders. We talk actually about this in our high school social council this week, but we know we'll have some parents that want their students, you know, on a college campus in ninth grade, and that's fine. Allow us for that. We certainly would, honor that. But our focus in terms of recruiting is on the classroom. And, Lawrence, he's here to say this, we've got some 10th graders here this year at their choice. And, it's just a lot of maturity.
But they need 8 credits of high school. Our feeling is that if you get those 8 credits and do those first 2 years,
right.
that's really what we want you to get a solid background and prepare, but there will always probably be exceptions.
There will be.
But really, if someone asks us today, I think we say, let's do those first 2 years of high school, you can get to 16, you've got a good background, and then you can move on into different paths with that.
Yeah, this is the exception.
I got one quick question, I'm sorry, I just love this subject, but in terms of the high school pathways, are they also like two block? I mean, I don't know how the phrasing, are they single courses?
One course, one period course. Once they go over a year long now, we're not blocking more than high school.
Okay, so and that's true with the Athens Tech courses as well?
No, they're semester.
Those are semester two block.
Anything other on this campus, including Clarke City, are on block.
They two block, semester one block.
So students would come over, take a class, and go back?
They go over in the morning, they come over, we only have for in the mornings. The old father could be go to morning and afternoons next year, but we said we want to plus. So kids come over in the morning, they take classes until 11:30, then they go back to their homes.
Okay, so they would take other classes here too?
Yes.
Yes.
Like English and?
We offer that through Classic City.
Right, okay.
So when someone comes to the Career Academy, so let me give you an example. If someone wanted to go into a job through Great Promise Partnership, but the way the scheduling worked, I couldn't make it work with the year-long schedule. They could still remain a Clarke student. They come through the Career Academy, take high school quote, academic courses, fulfill that, and do their jobs. I mean, we're very flexible.
But if I was to take that culinary arts class next year, if I signed up for that, then I would maybe I would have that in the morning, and then I would take English and maybe another subject, and then in the afternoon, go back to the high school.
That'd be correct. That'd be correct.
If it works out that way.
But you know the great thing about the great thing about this schedule here though is like a college schedule. So we have kids that are free. They're we're at a media center, it's a college setting, we're like a student center. They do the work. They talk or they socialize or it's like college. Okay. So with that, I'm just gonna get my any other questions? So with that, I would ask that we approve the 2016-17 high school program of study with those changes as discussed.
Okay, item 14, that's the program of study for the high schools, and as Dr. New said, with the changes and revisions that were made, I'll entertain a motion. Got a set up. Move. Stewart. Got a second some place here. Second by Ms. Davis. Any questions? Any further questions? All in favor? All right. Thank you very much.
That it really is not new money, it's just where it comes from. As you know, the property fund is 101 is where we establish when we sale a property, sale of land, and that's where we work that piece. What we're asking at this point is that we know that we approved the architect firm and fee structure for West Broad, and what we want to do is to take it out of property 101, but we don't have enough money in property 101 until we get the money from the sale of our building.
Right.
So we're asking, if I got this right, Sam, we're asking is that we want to transfer $360,000 from our general fund to 101, and as soon as the sale of this building, it will go back into the general fund. It certainly happens.
Right.
That would be my recommendation.
Okay, the recommendation from the superintendent for the property fund of 101 West Broad Project expense of $360,000 to be transferred from the general fund to the property fund 101, and then once we sell the building, we go back.
Yes.
That's his recommendation. Move by Mr. Payne?
Yes.
Got a second? Got a second? Second by Ms. Ellis. Any further questions on this? Any further questions? All in favor? Okay, we got a unanimous. Okay. 16.
Number 16 is a document that's not new to the board. It's something that we sent out from the legislative committee. This is not an official vote that's saying that this is what we're going to lobby for, but what I'm asking for is that these are the legislative issues and the dynamics around those issues that we've identified as a board. And that allows, I think, the board to agree, then the government relations can begin to make sure strategically we get information out on certain pieces of this. We don't know if all of this will come up in the legislature, so it's not like we know. We just said these are topics that have been out there, and we just ought to make sure that we identify that if they come up, we need to take some, you know, we need to have information about that and its impact for our school. State funding is one, as you know from the Reform Commission, that there's going to be a change in that. I think, Mr. Hamill, that's coming out in is it this year or next year?
Well, there's been some talks on the legislation about having more input by the teachers because of the merit pay stuff. So there's a possibility that they may delay it for one more year to get teacher input from what I'm reading in the bylines. I understand they're coming out in the emails I get every day.
And so what's happening is I think we need to stay tuned to that because we don't know what the implications are when you start changing the funding. We're already starting to see some funding recommendations coming out. From teacher raises, et cetera, came out today. But we ought to know this, it's really not new money, it's really some of the, they're just putting back the austerity and targeting it to certain areas. I think there's a lot in there, but you sort of have to take it first at face value and then decide, what does that really mean when we get our final sheet?
So they're recommending over $300 million in reduction austerity, but the governor wants everybody gets that $300 million to give the teachers a 3% pay raise,
yeah,
which won't pay for it, but that's money you need for the basic needs anyways of what you're trying to do, and they took away at the beginning back in 2002.
Yes.
So I think it's a noble piece. I think if you remember correctly, you know, certainly we all need to look at compensation. We have a compensation study, and I just want to be clear, I think our teachers and our staff have been going a long time without much of a raise.
Right.
Remember, we took furlough days back. We put those, and so we've been pretty good in the last year. But again, I think it's still going to be the totality of budget. And the governor, if you remember correctly, in the governor's budget, we did tag it to teacher raises because there were a lot of furlough days. And if you read the paper today, part of this rationale is because there's not as, that people should have got rid of their furlough days, that this would go to salary increases.
Dr. Manula, to the board, there are schools in my district still taking furlough days because of funding.
Yeah. It'll be interesting it's serious. how this plays out. But this talks about funding. This talks about such things as the education savings account, which is tax credit to give scholarships for private schools. There's a lot of pieces we have to keep our eye on of where money can go. So I think this is a very important one because it's not just about QBE, changing QBE, but it's other funding streams that gets on the bill. So I think, and as I said before, these will come up in 2 days. You have to be very careful. They'll be at it, especially toward the end, all of a sudden something will be attached to a bill. And you've got to be able to respond to it. So I think that's part of what the primary responsibility of the Government Relations Committee getting information out really quickly, at least during this session. SPLOS funding, we haven't heard really any more about SPLOS funding. We just put that on because there's conversations that at some point in time they were talking about using SPLOS funding to do maintenance or even operations. And so I haven't heard much there. Gun control, we haven't, but I think you're going to start seeing gun legislation still come out. There was some strong conversation about the ability of teachers to carry guns in schools. Probably more important is whether students at universities can carry concealed weapons. Haven't heard much, but I think that'll probably come out somewhere. Opportunity school district, you're already starting to see that. That conversation, just an FYI. The legislation to put it on the ballot as a constitutional amendment has already passed. And the supporting legislation has already been passed.
Yes.
So the question for this, of course, is going to be is that there will be a ballot item that's going to say Opportunity School District. And we've had lots of conversation. We'll continue on that. I haven't heard anything of whether someone wants to change the legislation that governs how that happens. I haven't heard anything about that. I'm not sure that'll come back up on the table, but that's what that's all about. Teacher leader evaluation, as you know, been very vocal about that since its inception. I sent to the board, I submitted with a thank of help of Tim Jarbo, who's here, and Mark, and several of us, and Sherry, that we submitted an alternative, what we think is a good model for how we use growth in evaluating teachers. I sent that to Senator Tippins and others. I think it's at least got some looks and conversation. I guess when I get emails back, that's a good start. That doesn't just fall out there. Sent another sort of revision I'll send to you today that talks about, in talking with the State Board of Ed, Matt Jones, about looking at adding a professional development as part of that growth measure. And so we put several things together. So here's what I would say. We are probably the only ones that have put something on the table that said, I think this could work in a whole much better in terms of having the correct conversations about connecting performance and practice in real time. So feel pretty good about that.
Dr. Lynn, I got one question about that, because I skimmed over what you wrote and I really liked it. When we knock it down, with that 20% piece, you talked about using three instruments.
Three indicators.
And three indicators. So what would be some possible indicators that would, you would use?
What's up to three.
Up to three.
The big change that I'm suggesting at this point is that, number one, you don't have to do slopes. And in fact, the way we structured it is that the evaluator will determine the growth measure rather than having it go into a computer and spit out a number, right, and then you put it on a grid and give a score. The reason is that if we're having conversations all along the way about performance and linking to practices, that's much more effective than actually teaching and then dropping a score and saying this is where you're at. It's not a conversation. The part about the three indicators, and we've got several examples, but we may decide, for example, that we'll use the growth percentile. Tim, we had some of the growth percentile in a language arts. Then we'll use SRI data, which is a literacy. And we may decide to use either a performance pass that we design, or it could even be the grade third quarter. And what we would do is design a rubric to create the conversation and say, is there adequate growth when you discuss all these three together? Much more effective than a single measure growth model where you give a test in August and then a test in April and figure out.
So the milestone is already a given. That's not what.
Well, we changed that. In fact, if you'll notice, we did not say that the milestone would have to be an indicator in that sequence. And the reason why is you don't get the milestones in time. So, you know, it just seemed odd to be talking about your practice, right, based on growth from how you thought the previous year. That makes sense. So, we moved from 50% to 20%. We think it's reasonable. The next iteration we talked with Matt Jones today was a proposal to put 30% in around professional development. That's going to have some of the PLC work. But nonetheless, I think it's creating a very different conversation. Mm-hmm.
Right.
And please, any other of the government relations, if I haven't talked about something in its totality. I think the next piece is the teacher recruitment, retainment, professional development. That's the compensation. You're seeing some pieces. I think it's going to be really interesting because I think there's finally an understanding is that we're going into a huge teacher shortage.
Yes, we are.
We are. And I think people are realizing that I think that's where compensation, I think that's where some things are coming. But this may not be out of this legislation, but I think you need to hear the talk. Do you know what I mean? Because this may be the backdrop to some other bills. So that's what I'm recommending that we vote to say these are reasonable topics for us to be aware of.
It doesn't go to the substance of any of this, but there's a significant typo in the intro paragraph. It should be the 2016 session rather than the...
Yeah, you know what? This was last year's. Yes. Yeah. Thank you.
There's also a typo at the bottom there versus ineffective. So where's the bottom, very bottom, first page, very bottom.
Which one is
yeah.
It's a spacing. Got it. Thank you. I will double check it.
You made a recommendation. The superintendent made a recommendation to accept these legislative priorities. Need a motion on that? Moved by Mr. Parks, seconded by Mr. Davis. Okay, any further questions about these legislative priorities?
I'm going to slip in a question.
Go ahead.
Because we covered it in the same doc discussion. We talked about the fair dismissal, which is not part of this, I understand that. But as part of being part of the charter application.
Yeah, that's part of the charter.
We're still moving in that direction?
Yes, part of the charter. Right, yeah, Tim is here, yes, go ahead.
Mr. Payne?
Mine is coming. AJC did a survey and one-third of the educators voted in the last election. I don't know what can be done or what we can do. If anybody needs to know, they need to go to the poll, it's educators who have not been paid in several years, have been given a raise, and they should know what's going on under the gold dome. And they're not going to the poll. And we cannot change anything unless you go to the poll and change, get the people out. That's what you have to do, and I'm praying hard.
Okay, you have a question, Ms. Thornton?
I'm just gonna make a statement that I think I sent it out to everybody, that Cobb County also has their legislative priorities, and what I thought was interesting, three of ours are the same as theirs. So there is a growing interest and movement legislatively. And I think, I didn't mention, and I don't even know if this is the place to say that, but Valerie Wilson will be on a conference call with us on Tuesday, and maybe a question would be, what other boards have legislative priorities that we can, because we're, as far as I know, Dr. Leneau is the only superintendent that has at least offered something else. So people have legislative priorities, but they're not offering other suggestions. So I think that speaks very highly toward the journey.
Yeah, glad you brought that up, Ms. Thornton, because I think it was at the legislative committee meeting in November where we had Paige, GAE, Spencer Fry, we also had Dr. Jimmy Stokes, and several comments were made that, hey, perhaps Clarke County has the only Board of Education as a legislative committee, so perhaps what we're doing is catching fire, because as Mr. Payne said, that's the only way you're going to make the decision with this. Okay, if there's no further questions, all in favor of legislative process. Okay? Yeah, okay. Unanimous vote, okay?
The next is to submit the response to DOE feedback. This completes that whole review cycle, and Tim is here, but it is really, the reported letter just spells out what we went through in terms of that there were charter changes. Goes into a little bit more detail, but it is simply a letter of response. It's not the actual change, correct, Tim? So maybe is there any more that you'd like to add to that?
I can just.
Speak loudly, Tim. There you go.
So basically, we went at length last time over what we said. We basically took all of that, pasted that into the document, because we have to respond by bullet item that they, in the order that they sent that. For you, the main thing, and we made a few little tweaks in wording for the clarity of the message. And basically, the only things in here that we had to change from the original charter application, we said that principals would become co-chairs with another member of the council that's not an employee of Clarke County, and that they would both have voting rights then. That's one change. We did put a change in there that the governance teams would have an annual meeting in which they would give feedback on the strategic goals of the district and the budget, because they asked us about that, so we added both of those pieces. We revised the implementation schedule for governance teams, given the fact that the original charter, we thought we would already be approved as a charter district, so we had to adjust that schedule of when we would start the training and such for governance teams. We did have to put in a, we have to put in a statement in there that acknowledges we won't use the waivers to generate extra money for our district. That's just a requirement they asked. And then we also said that we would put a statement in there, and this is really not something they asked us to do, but it came from the discussion at the board meeting and with some of the different teacher members of our district, a statement that the district plans to follow Fair Dismissal Act guidelines as a charter district. So those are the only things we really are changing that are different from our original submission.
The rest is just clarification. The rest was them asking us, explain what you mean by this. So we did.
So with that, again, I want to thank James Barlin and Tim. I mean, this was, and Denise, just helping get feedback. And I would say this, I think we should feel really good about the transparency. I mean, we have let our community know every step of the way, you know, what we were doing, what we were saying, it was there, and getting feedback. So with that, I recommend approval of our response letter to the Georgia DOE on our charter system.
Okay, the recommendation from the superintendent to submit a response to Georgia DOE. Okay, approved by Mr. Payne, got a second by Mr. Davis. If there are no further questions, show your right hand, please. Okay, motion passed.
And then ask to approve the personnel recommendation for Denham and the two job descriptions I talked about, which was the coordinator for the Great Promise Partnership, as well as for the culinary coordinator and instructor that would be in our new high school culinary program for next year. Of course, that's always pending on enrollment, so, but I'd ask approval of those three.
Okay, the recommendation from the superintendent on the personnel recommendation that was included in your iPad and also that were two job descriptions that you just mentioned. And I need a motion on that. Moved by Mr. Payne, got a second on that. Second on that. Second from Ms. Ellis. All in favor? Okay, thank you, guys. Unanimous.
Therefore, I recommend that we go into, well, you can
Ms.
go
Davis,
into.
Ms. Davis, did you abstain? I'm
yes.
Sorry.
I then recommend that you, not me, I recommend executive session for the purpose of evaluation of the superintendent.
Okay, need a motion on that. Moved by Ms. Thorne, second by Mr. Huff. All in favor?